Bitmovin is here. Sean from Bitmovin is going to talk to us about common cloud encoding myths. Please have a lot of good questions. I think it's going to be a great discussion. And at the end of it, oh, it's a sweet prize you can't buy in stores because it's sold out. Stay tuned. Take it away, Sean.
Cool. Thank you, Troy. So my name's Sean. I'm with Bitmovin. I'm going to talk about common encoding myths. And in full transparency, I got the majority of the content from a Frost and Sullivan article. So Avni Rambia wrote an article or a white paper about winning strategies and getting smart about cloud-based encoding. So I printed out a bunch of these, and they're sitting right up there. If you guys find this an attractive topic, just come up and grab one. But this should be good if this is the only encoding topic we've done all week. It's pretty broad. I'm going to talk just very broadly about some of the differences between cloud-based encoding and hardware-based encoding. So hopefully you can learn some things. So here are the things that I hear most often around cloud-based encoding. You hear quite a bit about quality and efficiency. People talk saying that cloud-based encoding is not as good, the quality is worse, or it's not as efficient as the hardware encoding. So we'll talk about that. I hear quite a bit about cost. It's lower cost in one scenario or another. We hear a lot about reliability, and there's misconceptions about reliability that I want to talk about. And then vendor lock-in. There's a lot of concern, especially the way the video industry has developed around not getting locked in. So let's talk about quality first, and I'll address those two things. So is it true that quality is not as good in the cloud as it is in a hardware-based encoder? And the answer to that question is it depends. So it's not necessarily true or false. It depends on what kind of software you use. The truth of the matter is the high majority of encoding software built today was built with a fixed hardware mindset. It was built with the assumption that it's going to go on appliance or in some type of fixed mode within the cloud. And if you're an engineering team or an operations team and you are focusing on building a highly efficient encoder that has a controlled environment, like an appliance, the majority of your innovation and your engineering focus is going to be on trying to make that machine work as efficiently as possible. So you're trying to see how much encoding you can squeeze out of a single GPU or a set of GPUs or CPUs. So you really focus on that. And that's the majority of the software that's out there today. And if you take that software that is highly optimized for a specific environment and you port it and put it into the cloud, it's not going to operate as well. It's just not. And I think that's what most people's experience are with cloud encoding, that they've gotten in situations like that and they've compared it to the hardware encoding and it's just not as good. And naturally, it's not going to work as good if you do that. But it's not all software stacks are created equally. So Bitmovin's been around for 7 years and we've never had an appliance. We've always done cloud-based encoding. So we've always thought about encoding from a cloud perspective. So our innovation and our engineering and our focus has not been around how can we optimize the codec 10% more for this particular GPU and really get the best out of it. Our innovation and what we've always done is thinking about how can we leverage the cloud more efficiently in order to drive better performance. And specifically, how can we take files and split them up into the appropriate amount of segments and run them off of a variety of resources and then stitch them back together in the most efficient way possible that drives quality. And that's just a different track for an engineering team than an appliance team. So our software, if you took the software that we design and how it works and you put it on an appliance, it would work significantly worse because we designed all of our engineering about the ability to use the cloud. So whether or not something performs better or worse in the cloud depends on the software and how it was written and how it was architected. Ours works a lot better in the cloud, but most software stacks don't. Here's a good analogy of kind of how we've built ours and the way our software thinks about an encoding job. When an encoding job comes in, we first look at how big that encoding job is and make decisions as to how afar, we need to scale horizontally in order to execute at a very, very high quality level. If it's a small little canoe that comes in, then it can, you know, a couple CPUs are fine. If it is a massive HEVC 1 hour file, we want to scale that appropriately so that you can get it through the system as quickly as efficiently as possible. This has allowed us to have the same exact stack for both VOD and live, which is rare. Because most of the time live requires a lot more resources and a lot more quality. But for us, it's the same mindset. It's just a bigger file that needs to be pushed through quicker. So it's just leveraging the same core innovations that we have. So probably the easiest way to test this and actually see how software works is to time it. See how it performs with big jobs. And this is something that our software does exceptionally well because of the way we designed it for the cloud. If you take a 1 hour file that you're going to put in MPEG-DASH or convert to MPEG-DASH and HLS in 10 different bit rates, here's how long it would take. We can get that job done in about 3 minutes using our enterprise class encoding platform. And the reason why is because of the way the software was developed. We can also take things like an AV1 stream. So at the NAB, we won Streaming Media Best of Show Award by the guys at Streaming Media, and thank you, Streaming Media. And the reason why we won it is because we took AV1, which is a codec that is not even finished yet, and we directed it to our cloud, and we streamed it live on the NAB floor. A live signal of AV1. And nobody else has even touched AV1 yet, and we're doing a live signal over a 1.5 megabit connection of 1080p. It was pretty incredible. And the reason why we're able to do that, and this is important because it's the trivia question for later, is because we distributed that effectively across the cloud. We used Google Cloud Compute, and we distributed it correctly, and it worked perfectly on the cloud floor, or on the NAB floor. So, are cloud encoders lower quality? Well, it depends. A lot of the software written today would be lower quality in the cloud, but it doesn't necessarily have to be if you use the right software. Is hardware encoding more efficient? That depends on how you define efficiencies. Is it more efficient in the way it interoperates with a specific chipset or a GPU or CPU? Absolutely. It's designed to work with a specific chipset, and it's going to be more efficient there. But is it more efficient in the way it works in the cloud, in cloud resources? Again, it depends on which software stack you have. Ours is much more efficient in the cloud. Most software stacks are much more efficient on hardware. Okay, so let's talk about cost. It's another thing that comes up a lot. I think the majority of people, when they think of comparing cloud costs to hardware costs, they're thinking about it as I can buy a lot of hardware equipment and I can amortize that over a period of time, and then it's basically free after that. Whereas if I sign up for a cloud service, I'm going to be paying forever, and maybe those costs even go up. And I think that is a misconception and a fundamental misunderstanding as to how cloud software works. Because cloud software can be run in the same exact financial model. We sell our cloud encoding software in the cloud, and you can buy it as a service, but you can also just buy the software and put it on your own commodity servers in your own OpenStack or your own wherever you want it, and amortize it the same exact way you would any other solution. So you don't have to buy it as a service, you can buy it the same way. But you can also burst, right? So kind of the ideal scenario when you think about efficiencies and cost efficiencies is you buy the least amount you can to run at 100% efficiency. You'll never get to 100% efficiency, but if you buy enough encoding where all the encoders and all the commodity stuff you have is running 100% of the time, and then at the times where you're above that, you're bursting into the cloud so that you don't have to buy extra encoders in order to that run at 10, 15, 20% efficiency. That's the ideal scenario. And because, the way we've developed our software, it's the same exact workflow on the top, whether it's going to your your cloud environment to Amazon to Google. It's all the same, it's just in a different endpoint. So it's very easy to burst into the cloud, and that's the best way to get cost efficiencies is to buy as little as possible and then burst when you need to. So, I mean, I think that particular myth of on-premise encoding being lower cost is just wrong. It's just people don't understand how to buy the software and how to set it up correctly. The next one is, are hardware solutions more reliable? So their hardware solutions have been around for a while. You can set them up in HA configurations, and a lot of people have, where they have huge stacks of hardware encoders that fail over very well, and you can get very close to 100% uptime in these types of situations, and people are really happy about that, right? So, and then people hear stories of Amazon going down all the time and people having their services in Amazon and that goes down. And so I have this thing that works almost 100% of the time and you're telling me to go to Amazon, and I know from reading the Wall Street Journal that that goes down quite a bit. But again, I think that depends on the software you have. So if you have software that is built to run in a fixed environment, that is the case because it doesn't scale well, it doesn't move well. Again, the way we've built our software is it's always been cloud independent, it's always been CPU independent, and it all has the same exact workflow and API structure on the top. So you build it once, and then you can run it anywhere. So if you can run it anywhere, you can run it in Google, Azure, Amazon, your own cloud instances, wherever it is, then theoretically you can get infinite amount of reliability. And because all you have to do is fail over between those two if something wrong happens to Amazon. And I think a lot of people don't think about that when they think in the cloud, I'm going to be running an Amazon in Virginia, and if Amazon Virginia has problems, I'm going to be a victim. But if you're running an Amazon Virginia, you can easily just fail over somewhere else, and you can even write a script to look at that and fail over automatically, so you don't have to do it manually. So again, I think are they more reliable? I think it depends, again, on the software and the configuration you have. If you set it up correctly using the right cloud software and your needs are to have 100% uptime, you can do that in the cloud. You just need to configure it and set it up and architect it properly. Okay, and the last one is around vendor lock-in. There's been a lot of vendor lock-in in the video ecosystem over the last 10 years. And it has been a very real thing, so I certainly understand why that myth is out there. But again, it depends on the stack and kind of how you set things up. Our software, we sell software that's 100% standards compliant. So our encoding stack works with any player, with any advertising platform, it works with any DRM, it works, it's interoperable with everything. And we run on a variety of different cloud infrastructures. For on-premise, there's tons of open source options available. Kubernetes is an open source platform that we run a lot in. Docker is easy to set up. So there's a lot of options as to how you set things up. If somebody was running our software with their own player and they decided to replace our encoding software with their own player, that wouldn't be a problem. They could still have the stuff with Amazon or Google, however they want. You could take ours out. You can replace a cloud vendor. I look at this as being really, really modular and easy to move around. So I don't really see the vendor lock-in. So that was kind of the last myth. Kind of addressed the ones that I thought were most relevant, the ones that I hear about in the marketplace the most. But I'll open up to you guys. Are there other things that you hear about encoding or specific myths that about cloud encoding that you want an answer to?
Who's got a question? Raise your hand and I'll come around to the mic. Okay, over here, we got a couple. We've got time for several. Okay.
So you mentioned multiple flavors. How do you handle the workflow to determine how the file should be processed?
So our approach on all the software we build is it's really built by developers for developers. That's kind of our tagline. So how you set that up is incredibly flexible, and it's all set up through our APIs. So you can either ask for our advice, and we've got lots of blogs written on all those kind of things, or you can just set it up yourself. But everything's incredibly configurable.
Okay, another question here. Did you?
How do I ingest a live feed into the encoder from an on-premise, show?
Yeah, you just just get a feed, get a feed with a URL and direct it specifically to our platform.
Traditional encoder, hardware encoder would have like, let's say, an SDI input, right? Capture card?
Yeah, so you're going to need to have some type of transcoder that puts it in, a format that can be sent online,
So I still require a hardware encoder to encode in the cloud?
Sometimes, yeah. I mean, a lot of times you need MPEG transport or, some type of, way to get it online. Generally that can be done on site. That's changing a lot now, that a lot of broadcasters are kind of moving over to OTT. So we see actually a lot of situations where on-site encoders right in the truck or wherever it might be are actually putting it in OTT formats that we can absorb directly into the cloud. But you're right, there often is a situation where there unfortunately is like a single point of failure in a single box that is just doing some transmuxing into an OTT format. But I think that's a problem we deal with all the time, but I think that's going to go away. I think we're probably, a year away from that. That's a good question, though.
Okay, next question.
I'll be dealing with some of the issues about live ingest and video production, so 2022-6 and transport stream and how you handle that. So if you hang around for the session at 3:15, a few answers there.
Good.
Question but an answer. All right, anybody else? Okay, over here. Your pardon?
So with traditional encoding, you're gonna usually have one or two video signals going into the encoder. If you do cloud encoding, if that traditional encoder breaks, you could potentially lose those signals, you lose that feed. Could cloud encoding potentially reduce that risk by having multiple cloud encoders using that same video feed? So you could have four or five cloud encoders using that video feed. If one goes down, it automatically fails over to the other, and you lose that risk. Mm-hmm. Is that something that's a potential?
Yeah, it's not only potential, but that's exactly how we designed and architected our software. So when a live stream comes in, the first thing we do is kind of figure out how we're going to resource that in order to deliver the quality. And then we our core innovation as a company is splitting that up. So we split that up into many different pieces and assign it to the different resources and then stitch it back together at the back end. So if any one of those resources we lose, we just have to reassign that piece and stitch it back together. So the stitching is kind of our core innovation, and it's a perfect model for problems because there are always problems in the cloud. Things are guaranteed to fail in the cloud constantly, or you get blocked out of certain situations. And you need to have a system that picks up very quickly. And that's where we've focused our innovation. So yeah.
Okay, one here.
So sorry, I missed the first 2 minutes of the presentation, but do you deliver this as a SaaS service? Do you deliver an image which I configure? Do you come and configure this for me? How do you deliver the business model?
Yeah, that's a great question. So we started as a SaaS provider. And for our first 5 years or so, we were purely SaaS. Lately we've been selling the software, and specifically just taking the cloud software we have and the entire SaaS platform, if you will, and putting it in somebody else's instance. And that instance could either be in their own cloud or it could be in their own Amazon cloud or their own private Google cloud or whatever it might be. So we do it both ways now, in order to meet customers' needs.
Okay, we can do one more. Anybody with a question? Anybody?
The only common thread, just to answer your question, is for us right now is Kubernetes. Kubernetes is kind of the platform that we highly suggest. We don't have to have it, but it makes it super easy. If you're running Kubernetes in your own instance, you can run it in Amazon, Google, Azure, wherever you want. Then it makes it super easy for us to build that top layer and assign resources properly, and then change. So if you want to put everything in Amazon, but you have a one-year plan to eventually migrate things onto Google or migrate things into your own data center. You can set it up in one place, get going right away, but then over time or as needed, you can change, and there's no change to the workflow you set up. We sometimes do. We can, yeah. So we're really a developer-first platform. So our best customers, speaking honestly, are companies that have really good developers that can get right in and kind of work with us on that. So, but we do offer premium support in which kind of our development team works kind of hand in hand with the development team of our customers in order to kind of meet deadlines, you know, produce product, etc.
Okay, round of applause for Sean, who did a great job telling us about the coding mix.